right, and I'm hoping, Chair, that the one who does show up is Josh Green. I'm sure he's going to have a lot of stuff to add if this budget, if he doesn't. Hopefully, there'll be something to follow up on.
Bert Kobayashi.
Thank you, Vice Chair Halpin.
Della Bellotti, member of the Health Committee and House Majority Leader.
David Tarnas, I represent the Kohala District on Hawaii Island.
Tina Wildberger from South Maui.
Thank you very much, members. At this time, I'm going to bring up Hilton Rado of the Healthcare Association of Hawaii. He'll be explaining to us what the hospitals are doing and what protocol they have to protect us against the novel coronavirus. Mr. Rado, please. Yes, sir.
Chair Mizuno, Vice Chair Kobayashi, thank you for the opportunity. My name is Hilton Rethel. I'm the President and CEO of the Healthcare Association of Hawaii. We represent all of the hospitals in Hawaii, including AAA public and private hospitals and all our long-term care, all the long-term care facilities, home care, hospice, etc. We are actively working with the Department of Health. We very much appreciate the collaboration with Dr. Anderson, Dr. Park, and their collaboration with the CDC. So we are talking and meeting on a very regular basis. We had a meeting on Monday afternoon with all the mayors. We had a conference call with the governor and all the department heads on Saturday. We had another conference call with the governor and all the department heads. Lieutenant Governor Josh Green was in both of those as well. We had another one yesterday. Had a call with the American Hospital Association and the CDC at 7 o'clock this morning. So there is literally daily communication that is going backwards and forwards in regard to this particular virus. The hospitals in Hawaii, at this point in time, it's very, very important to remember that we have not had any confirmed cases of the novel coronavirus in Hawaii, nor have we even had any suspected cases of this virus in Hawaii to date. So we're very fortunate from that perspective. However, as you're aware from the news reports, this virus has now been identified in 26 countries, and it's suspected. There are suspected cases in 36 states across the U.S. right now, with Hawaii not being one of those cases. Our hospitals are very, very prepared to take care of any cases if they are suspected or if they are confirmed. There is screening that is going on at the airports, which the other testifiers can talk about in more detail. So there is a lot of screening there, but our hospitals also are doing screening as well. And right now it's two-factor screening that is going on, so all of the entry points to our hospitals, whether it's inpatient, outpatient, emergency room, surgery, anything like that. Now, the two factors of screening is, does anyone, are they experiencing flu-like symptoms? Now, the challenge with this, this particular virus is that the symptoms are very similar or indistinguishable actually from the regular flu. So that is the first question, are you experiencing any flu-like symptoms? And the second one is, have you traveled to this impacted area in China or been in contact with someone who has traveled to this particular area in China? So those are the two screening questions that all patients are going through right now. We do have adequate supplies of personal protective equipment for all the staff and patients and visitors in hospitals. We also do have what we call negative pressure isolation rooms on all islands across the state, so that if a patient does need to be admitted, they can be quarantined appropriately. And again, we have all the personal protective equipment that is necessary. This is, in terms of personal protection, it's very similar to other forms of the flu or influenza. So there is no need from the Department of Health, CDC, there is no need for anything like hoods and respirators, full body suits. This is like, it's the same type of protections you take for the flu, which is putting a mask. If someone believes they have it, or someone is suspected of having the virus, that they will actually be given a mask and then be isolated appropriately. Quarantine period is, according to the CDC, the incubation period
The average is about 5 days, but it can vary from 1 to 14 days at this point in time. We also have a second layer of defense here with our, in Hawaii, we have a emergency services coalition. And so in the, we also have backup supplies of protective equipment, masks, et cetera, things like that. So protocols have been worked out in terms of transporting patients if patients are identified at the airport, for example. Our regular AMR service can transport those patients appropriately. They have all the protective, appropriate protective equipment, and they can be transported to a hospital for diagnosis and further screening. So again, at this point in time, we believe we are very, very well prepared. And again, just to reinforce that to date, we've had no confirmed cases or not even any suspected cases here in Hawaii. So thank you. I'm available for further questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just wanted to recognize two of our other colleagues that came in, Representative Tokioka, and next to Representative is Representative Rita Cabanella. Thank you for being here. Okay. Is the Department of Transportation here? DOT.
Dr. Eileen is here.
Oh, yes. Doctor, can you come on up and sure. Dr. Ireland, can you give us the breakdown of the protective measures we all are taking at Daniel K. Inouye International Airport to protect our people from contracting that novel coronavirus?
Sure. I'm James Ireland. I'm the medical director for the firefighters and our firefighting unit at the Honolulu International Airport. Normally, on a kind of weekly basis, I help them with their training and we work on their medical responses, the AED program. But part of the broader scope of what we do there is also monitor for infectious disease. Now, fortunately, we have a CDC station at the airport, and it's a federal agency that takes the lead on international travelers with potentially infectious diseases. And when avian influenza was a concern many, many years ago, and SARS, a screening program was developed. And there is a contracted paramedic from American Medical Response who's at the airport 24/7. And in addition to responding to medical emergencies at the airport, they were also trained more than 10 years ago to do swabbing for avian influenza. So the mechanism is there to detect patients with potentially infectious diseases. Now, about right around 10 years ago or so, H1N1 influenza, which was a novel flu virus, came up, and it reminds me a lot of what's happening now, in that it was new, people didn't have antibodies to this, we didn't want it to come to Hawaii, and we had to expand our screening program to protect ourselves. And this is similar in a sense. Now, when this was first kind of came on the radar about right around a month ago or so, right around first week in January, we started watching and to see what the developments would be in Asia, and it turned out that this was indeed a fairly aggressive virus in that it does spread. Fortunately, the death rate appears to be quite low, not zero, but quite low. And from all accounts that I personally can see from just the study of the cases and what's happening is it seems like it's a bad flu, although it's not a flu virus, it's a different virus. And currently there is not a vaccine for it, although I understand that that's in development. So when this came on the radar a few weeks ago, we re-engaged our partners at the airport, which is collaboration between AMR, the DOH, the state, the DOT, and the CDC, to re-look at our screening program and if it needed to be changed or adjusted or expanded. And since that has occurred, now it does include coronavirus. Now, what was surprising, I think, for many people in Hawaii is what's come down from the federal level as far as making us a port of entry, and that was made last week. And so we even needed to adjust our protocols in that we might be getting planes diverted here or brought here. From my understanding, there are no direct flights as of today anymore from China, but we still have to be vigilant in the case that, for instance, a plane is traveling from China to the US mainland and there's a medical emergency on board and they need to land here. Or we also have to be ready that people who had traveled to China, Americans perhaps, that are coming from Korea or Taiwan or other countries in Asia. I'm pretty comfortable with the process that's been in place for many years and it's been adjusted for coronavirus, and we've had to augment the protocols to involve our partners, including the city, for a response if there was a case that was suspected that came to Hawaii. And again, this is evolving really daily because of the changes that are coming at the federal level. And I think the communication, at least at our local providers, has been quite good. And again, evolving every day, but through meetings with the governor's office and the various partners, trying to keep up with this on a day-to-day basis. But I'm comfortable in that at least we had the program in advance, so it was, I think, easier to augment it for this new virus based on the information we have.
Thank you. Before you go, I think we didn't ask questions of Clifton, but we'll come back. Members, did you have any questions for Dr. Ireland?
Yes, I have.
Representative Capanella?
Yeah. I know that the news are always talking about direct flights from Wuhan and direct flights from Beijing, but I do know that there are a lot of connecting flights from that area that might end up in our airport. Are they monitoring that?
From my understanding, the CDC and the federal government is doing that, and they are the lead on this. From the DOT and airport standpoint, is if we are notified that someone is here that needs swabbing, the American Medical Response paramedic at the airport will respond with the CDC to do the swabbing. And then the state Department of Health then is involved with, I think, deciding what will be done with the patient and or anybody else who's in quarantine. What I might add is since this has changed, since this new coronavirus was detected, we've also trained in Honolulu all of our airport firefighters in specifically how to deal with this coronavirus and swab for it. So we have now more people who are able to help assist AMR with the process of swabbing and screening if needed.
Thank you, Dr. Arman. I believe I had Representative Tokyo Kapaba by Minority Leader Ward.
I have a question for you. Okay.
Lieutenant?
No.
Oh,
Lieutenant.
Dr.
Guilty?
Yeah. Thank you for being here. One of the questions that I was asked this morning, as you know, with the local media, they have the facility at the airport and they're talking about if someone is found to have the virus, we're going to hold them over there. But they also said that they would be moved to a quarantine spot somewhere else on the island. Have you been in contact? Do you know where that site exists, or is that something you can tell us?
I don't.
And are they prepared for that?
Well, from the Department of Transportation standpoint, from the medical standpoint, for the care we give at the airport, our first concern is, does a person coming here need medical care? Do they need oxygen? Do they need IV fluids? Do they need something that we need to address immediately? Do we need to get them to a hospital? And if it is a suspected coronavirus patient, then we obviously will alert anybody responding to the airport, whether it's AMR or the city, that they need to use PPE or personal protective equipment. We'd also notify the hospital that's receiving the patient that this needs to be, you know, potentially isolated. So that is our role in providing medical care. If the CDC wants the patient swabbed, we'll do that as well. Leaving the airport, where they go, that really is a question, I think, for the federal authorities or the Department of Health. I don't have that information at this time, and I think that'd be better for them to answer.
Thank you, Dr.
Chair, if I can just interject.
Sure.
Members, I just wanted to apprise you for those who just walked in. There is a CDC meeting that was occurring with members of the Department of Health as well as members of the Department of Transportation at 12:30. They are on their way, and some of them, Deputy Director Rossi Gashi and Chief Jacobs, who are really the point people for the state team, are on their way. So we should reserve some of these questions as they make their way here. I do believe that we have Deputy Director Danette Tomiyasu, who can speak from the Department of Health perspective and provide information to this committee. So maybe if we do that and then take further questions, as we await, Director Anderson is on his way, as well as the Department of Transportation.
As well as Dr. Sarah Park, who are
and Dr. Park, who are also on their way.
Okay. Well, thank you, Majority Leader. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Arvin. I believe Minority Leader Ward had a question for Hilton.
I have a very brief question for Hilton. Hilton, thank you for
kicking this
off. You are very encouraging, but very discouraging. Encouraging in that, hey, we don't have a suspected case, we don't have an actual case, but then you turn around and say, oh, by the way, 36 states have got cases.
Suspected cases.
You said suspected cases.
36 have suspected cases, that is correct.
My question is, on a scale of 1 to 10, 1, no cases, 10, we're sure to get something suspected. What's the probability that we're going to get here, the 36 of these states have got suspected cases?
Well, if I can, I know Dr. Anderson is not here, but in the briefings that we've had over the weekend, both Dr. Anderson and Dr. Park have stated that they it's just a matter of time until we get a case here in Hawaii.
So it's a matter of time. It's not if, but when.
I'm quoting what they have said, yes.
How soon? No, you can't tell.
You're not too soon.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah.
Thank you. Any further questions? If not, we're going to go to Deputy Director Danny Tomiyasu. And I wanted to recognize you've got Representative Nakamura joining us along with Representative Scott Matayoshi. Thank you, Deputy Director.
Good morning, Chair Mizuno and members of the committee. My name is Danny Wong Tomiyasu. I'm Deputy Director of Health Resources Administration at the Department of Health. Director Anderson and Dr. Sarah Park apologize for not being here right at 1 o'clock because they're in a briefing right now. They should be down shortly to be able to answer questions that you may have. I'm here just to provide a brief overview and to be able to have to listen to any questions that come up. As Mr. Raythal has spoken, there are no cases of novel coronavirus in Hawaii and no cases under investigation at this time. This is a situation that is evolving quite rapidly, so we are constantly staying in touch with our federal partners, our state partners, our county partners, and our private partners as well on a daily basis to be able to keep up with the situation and to prepare for when we do have a case and prepare for whatever circumstances may arise. Since the beginning and we became aware, the Department of Health, we've been preparing and I don't know what was transmitted, but as on January 17th, there was reported 45 cases of the novel coronavirus and 2 deaths. Today, just a few weeks later, the virus has infected more than 17,000 people and caused more than 300 deaths in China. The cases have been increasing exponentially and events are evolving quite quickly. But we know there's a number of travel restrictions, so the number of visitors and people coming from Hubei province in particular are dwindling very rapidly. CDC Customs Border Patrol began enhancing health screening at major airports to detect ill travelers traveling to the United States from Wuhan, China. Since then, HHS has announced airport screenings expanded to 20 sites, including the Daniel Noi International Airport. On January 21st, the Department of Health issued a medical advisory to all healthcare providers on reporting, testing, specimen collection, and interim healthcare infection control recommendations for the 2019 novel coronavirus. Because this is new, it's novel, there's a lot unknown about this virus, and so there's constant information coming from CDC, which we are then also providing to our healthcare providers and to our partners. Providers were advised at that time to notify the Department of Health Disease Outbreak Control Division immediately if a patient meets the case criteria. On January 21st, DOH also issued a press release advising the public to receive flu vaccinations to prevent confusions, as persons with flu will have similar symptoms to the coronavirus. It's a respiratory illness, and so it's very common to see those kinds of same symptoms from flu. People with recent travel from Wuhan were advised to seek medical care right away after calling ahead to the healthcare provider. So we've advised people, and this is how most of the cases have been found, is that the people have recognized these symptoms, contacted their healthcare provider or doctor, and then been tested and then gone in for care. So most of the cases were not found at the airport, as most people are concerned about at this time. On January 29th, the department issued a press release and held a joint press conference with Governor Ige, the Department of Transportation, the Healthcare Association of Hawaii, and the Hawaii Tourism Authority to provide an update on emergency preparedness activities. The public was advised to stay well informed and to use credible government sources of information such as the CDC and the Department of Health websites for accurate and timely information. And at that time, the Department of Health also advised people not to travel to China or defer their travel. The web pages that were in your frequently asked questions are on there, and people can go to the CDC or the Department of Health website anytime for timely information. It was last week that the World Health Organization declared a global public health emergency of international concern. HHS Secretary Azar declared the outbreak a public health emergency for the United States and announced new travel restrictions and quarantine requirements. Department of Health continued to coordinate with county, city, state, and federal emergency response and private emergency response partners. So I just wanted to mention some of the actions that the department has taken at this time, and Dr. Sarah Park will be here to answer further questions. There's, it's a rapidly changing scenario, so the information that we provide today could very well be different than tomorrow, so please stay tuned. As I mentioned, we issued a medical advisory on January 21st, and we understand to make people aware of the situation and understand that the response is very urgent. We are continuing to update our DOH website to provide information as events evolve, and that's health.hawaii.gov. The department also issued a letter to schools and universities on January 30th and 31st with general guidelines, as we feel that there's a lot of misinformation going out, circulating in the community. So we ask the community members to be also very vigilant about staying abreast of the most current information and to take prevention precautions just as you would do for the flu. Washing your hands, sneezing in your elbow, very simple things that we all, I think, were taught very early on when we were young people, but don't always practice as well as we should. We continue to work with healthcare facilities to ensure hospitals and healthcare providers are up to date on infection control recommendations and patient assessments. We're communicating regularly with travel partners, public and private, to ensure the latest CDC guidance and information is being shared with all relevant personnel. The department has extensive protocols in place for infectious disease outbreak control and prevention activities. The department works with federal, state, county, private, and nonprofit organizations statewide on preparedness activities on a regular basis and prevention measures continually. This includes exercises that we have on a regular basis and drills with hospitals and HIEMA and Medical Reserve Corps, and of course, law enforcement. Most recently, DOH has been working with federal, state, and county response partners to coordinate the logistics and other issues around the potential quarantine of airline passengers who do not have residence in Hawaii. When a possible case of the novel coronavirus is identified anywhere in the state, the Hawaii Department of Health will immediately conduct an investigation and place the patient under quarantine while awaiting laboratory results. Currently, the only laboratory that can confirm novel coronavirus is at the CDC in Atlanta. We understand from a call actually today that the CDC is getting ready to provide test kits to states to be able to test in their own state. So we anticipate that happening in the next week or two, so that we will have the capability of actually testing here in Hawaii. Because as you know, to send a sample to CDC could take a couple, 3 days or more, and it takes a few days to actually run the test. And so we are really looking forward to having the test kits here in Hawaii so that we can do it on a more timely basis. I believe that's all the remarks I have, the general remarks that I have for now, and I anticipate they should be coming down shortly.
Well, yeah, we do see Dr. Sarah Park here.
Dr. Sarah Park is here to answer any questions you have about, and actually I would like her to share what we would be doing in Hawaii should we identify a case and what some of the preparations we are doing now.
Absolutely, Deputy Director, thank you. We can get Dr. Sarah Park, just an expert disease outbreak control, brief us. Thank you very much, Dr. Park, for being here.
Good morning. Thank you for having me here and this opportunity to help inform you all as well as our community, which is, I think, paramount right now because as Deputy Director has commented, I think one of our challenges right now is some of the misinformation that is going out to our community. And so making certain that they do have access to appropriate information, the up-to-date, most credible information, please reference our website as well as the CDC's website, even WHO, World Health Organization's website. Regarding what we would do in terms of identifying cases, should there be a person that we identify as a potentially fulfilling the criteria that the CDC has provided in guidelines to all public health, as well as broadly published for the communities, for all communities out there, should we find such an individual, that individual would be ill. We would presume that obviously has to have fever or cough or has shortness of breath, as well as travel to Hubei province, potentially also China, but really what we're talking about is Hubei province, and that group, by the way, is quickly narrowing because the lockdown in China occurred now, I think, 12 days ago. So we anticipate by midweek this week that group is almost non-existent outside of China. But should we identify such an individual, we would be working with our EMS partners, with healthcare facility partners. I guess I would back up and say it depends where we identify that individual, and quite frankly, I suspect it'll be someone who has already arrived in Hawaii and has not, you know, not showing any symptoms. And this is from previous to the current. It's kind of difficult right now because things have changed so dramatically. So maybe I should even just talk to the current scenario, which is that everyone is being screened. And so we would know about these individuals and they would be in mandatory quarantine, the hot zone folks. And right now, as far as we're aware, there's no one fulfilling that criteria. So if there were such an individual, they would already be in quarantine. And if they fell ill, because right now it's asymptomatic individuals, but if they fell ill, we would make sure that they go into appropriate healthcare facilities should they require that hospitalization. And I actually do anticipate these individuals will require at least initially hospitalization. So we would be working immediately with the hospital association. We have a great relationship with Healthcare Association of Hawaii, as well as with all the hospitals. We have been having ongoing conversation with all infection preventionists with the facilities, and in fact, I have a meeting, a conference call with my medical advisory group, which are physician providers that represent all the different professional societies and such. Essentially, we would make sure that individual got the appropriate healthcare, they would stay and remain in isolation for as long as CDC requires that they do remain in isolation. The answer to that, as far as the total number of days or whatnot, has not yet been determined. So at this time, they would be indefinitely in isolation until we deemed otherwise. If they were to recover from their medical care or from requiring medical care, we would work with the healthcare provider as well as the individual and potentially family to make sure the individual goes home to a secure home, that they remain in isolation at home, and we would continue to monitor that individual, again, with collaboration with our partners at CDC as well as others in the community. I think that pretty much sums up the scenario right now. And again, it is constantly changing. But I think the strength of what we do is in our partnerships, and that we have been having ongoing conversations with all the critical partners.
Thank you, Dr. Park. Before I go to the Department of Transportation, I'm going to see if there's questions from our colleagues. So, Minority Leader Ward, first, go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Dr. Park. This is right down your list. All the training that you've had is for such a time as this. Two questions. One, when you said there is misinformation out there, who's doing that and what are they saying? There's so little information, I didn't know there was a stream of false news.
I think our biggest challenge is in my years of experience with each event, I see the rise of social media as honestly a real challenge for those of us in working in public health. And it honestly, I feel, diverts really critical resources and efforts because a lot of times, I've actually heard colleagues on the call this an infodemic, occurring right now, that we're dealing with an infodemic at the same time as we're dealing with the actual disease concern. And so I'm asking all of you, as well as our community out there, to help us to make sure that the right information is out there to help us combat the rumors. How many, I would posit, how many see something on social media and actually fact check to make sure it's true? How many just take social media posts at face value? And so I'm asking everyone, no matter what you see out there in social media, fact check it. In fact, check it against our website, against CDC's website. Do not share and post things that you just see and think, oh my God, this must be what's really happening. But that's essentially what we're dealing with, what we're fighting against. And that's harmful to our communities because it's not getting the important messages out. We need to, as a community, prepare for the eventual likelihood that this virus will be in our communities. And we need to make sure the information is out there in terms of how we can combat it now. And it's exactly as Deputy Director has said, all those things that we learned as children, quite frankly, not sharing our germs. You know, when you're sick, when you're coughing or sneezing, cough or sneeze into your arm, don't spread your germs. Wash your hands, so important, and especially stay home when you're sick. Do not share your germs. That will be so critical when and if this virus starts to circulate in our communities. And we need to practice it starting now, because when we start to know about the cases that are actually, think about H1N1, think about SARS. Well, SARS, hopefully, I mean, we saw that the rise and end, but we're in a different world, I would say, now. Travel happens very quickly. In China, think about what they were like during SARS to now, their technology now compared to SARS, their rapid rail that they did not have back during SARS, which probably helped to perpetuate their situation to basically take sick people almost, you know, within an hour to their outer reaches. I mean, that really was a disservice for them, but we can do something now. We can do something now to protect our community.
Thank you, that was a very good public announcement. My second question, Chair, is in the narrative that you've given, you kept talking about the individual, we're gonna do this with them, we're gonna do that with them, but I didn't get a clarity of how you're gonna identify that individual. Are you going to interview them? Are you gonna see the passport?
Then we'll back up a little bit to give some clarity on the screening process, in that until a person, a traveler has cleared from Customs Border Protection, they are under federal authority. The screening process is being conducted by CBP, Customs Border Protection, in collaboration with the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. So there are quarantine officers at the airport that work for the CDC, and I understand there will be more that are going to be flown in or are flying in or here as I speak help support the existing staff that are already at the airport, Honolulu International or Daniel K.
How are you doing that?
And they will be, CBP asks every single traveler, have you been to China? Okay, when, where? And if they find that anyone, it'll be on their passport because they'll have been stamped, right? They see it, they'll defer those travelers to CDC staff for screening. And if there is someone from Wuhan, they immediately go into the mandatory quarantine group. Regardless of symptoms or not, they go into that special hot group, which frankly by Wednesday will be zero, okay? To explain that is that in order to have left Wuhan, they would have had to have left 12 days, 13 days ago now, which means the clock for that requirement for quarantine starts the minute you leave the area. So that is why by Wednesday, even if we find a traveler on Thursday, shall we say, that left Wuhan, they say they were in Wuhan, they had to have left long before the 14 days. So their quarantine period for that is over. Now, they may have been in China, so now they fall into a lesser group. So now if you have a traveler who says they've been in China, not accepting Hong Kong, Taiwan, and Macau, okay, but if you've been in other parts of China, all the rest of China, now you fall into this group where we would like you to stay in home quarantine. These people will be allowed, assuming they're asymptomatic, these people will be allowed to travel on to home destinations. So these people may be transiting through Honolulu and on their way to, say, LA, Seattle, Chicago, wherever. They'll be allowed to continue. CDC will notify us, DOH, as well as the final destination, public health department. And we in public health will do a warm handoff from one jurisdiction to the next. We will make contact with that individual. We will verify contact information. We'll verify status, and we'll hand off to the next jurisdiction. The last group is if it's a home resident of Hawaii. If these people are coming and they're coming out of China, and again, if they're asymptomatic, they will be asked to stay in home quarantine for 14 days from the time they left China. We will engage in active monitoring with those individuals, which means we will do daily checks with them and to make sure they stay in home quarantine, as well as to make sure that if they need healthcare, if they develop illness, that they get the appropriate assessment and healthcare that they need. If individuals are sick, we will work immediately with healthcare providers to assess whether this person needs to be in a healthcare facility, and then work accordingly to make sure that if they need to be in quarantine, they stay in quarantine.
So the only unknown variable is those who came in contact with somebody who was in Wuhan.
So hopefully that, well, it's not just did you come in contact. So
it's going to be hard
being
to tell.
Being like passing by someone in an airport or sitting next to someone for 10 minutes or even on the airplane necessarily does not put you at risk. It's really, did you have direct, close, person-to-person contact, household contact, intimate contact with a confirmed case. This risk group really would be caretakers or healthcare workers.
How close does it have to be?
I mean, we're talking about close contact, so household sort of interactions. Okay, so if you happen to be in transit in an airport with someone, you have to be sitting in the chair next to. You just happen to be there waiting for your flight. That does not constitute a close contact. Close contact is you're in the same household, you're in the healthcare facility, you are taking care of that person, you're in a household where you are providing that care, you're being exposed to the respiratory droplets that could then land potentially in your mouth, your nose, your eyes, and then cause you infection. That's what we're looking for.
Thank you. That's encouraging.
Thank you. I wanted to recognize Representative Cragen, who just came in.
Dr. Cragen.
We've got a couple more questions, Dr. Park. So I've got Representative Kobayashi, followed by Representative Cavanaugh, followed by Representative Nakamura.
I think you've partly answered what I wanted to say. My understanding is that the most likely type of transmission would be person to person.
Yes.
Not animals or animal products. Not touching of objects, and that the person-to-person contact has to be fairly close, either direct touching or sneezing.
Right. Right now, we feel the highest risk are to individuals who are caretakers or healthcare workers. That does not preclude people from hand washing. You're going to hear me say this over and over, sorry, but I'm going to say hand washing, trying to avoid touching our faces. As much as we can make this second nature, it helps us. And I would also add, as Deputy Director said, we're in the middle of flu season. If you will recall, I'll take you back to early December. What were the news headlines covering? All of them. Dr. Fauci from NIH, CDC, all of them were talking about it was the most severe flu season on record so far. Have you been hearing that still?
Yeah.
Not really, because everyone's focusing on novel coronavirus. But I would tell you, things have not changed. If you ask our healthcare providers on the mainland, for Hawaii, we watched that and said, yeah, we're seeing flu season start to pick up here, flu activity here, and we were watching and hoping we weren't going to have as bad a flu season as what we see our colleagues on the mainland. But I will tell you, the healthcare providers will tell you they're seeing plenty of flu. So I would also argue we would do our community a big favor by making, again, these simple prevention messages that I know I sound like a broken record and we've all heard it before, but making it really second nature. Because honestly, we could do a lot to help our community by decreasing the flu burden on our community, because when this virus circulates, You can imagine our healthcare providers trying to deal with flu disease, which still causes, you know, deaths and other significant morbidity in our communities, in addition to dealing with this new virus. And they look very much the same in the beginning.
Thank you. I believe we have a question from Representative Cavanillo.
Yeah, going back to what you said about the info-pandemic or info-endemic, you talked about it, and that's going
to... It's a term I've heard some colleagues use already.
So I was, because I'm getting it myself, I was wondering if you're going to institute or you already have, like, a hotline that I can give...
Yes, thank you for asking. So just, and here I would point to, we've been through these kind of things, unfortunately, before, and sometimes I feel like they're coming faster and more furiously. And so we've learned from lessons in the past, and we've always used 211, right? So nothing different. We are using 211 for all general questions. If you want to report a disease, so this is primarily for our healthcare providers, but of course our partners and individuals, say you think you might have it or whatnot, then you call our disease reporting line. But if you have a general question, I don't understand, what's this about the quarantine? What's this about this disease? What are your recommendations? You know, how about for school? How about this? Call 211. The other thing is you can also refer easily to our website. And we are posting frequently asked questions and answers on our website. We are constantly adding to that living document as we hear, we get feedback from all of our partners, all of you, the community. If we start to hear themes, we start adding. And I have to say right now, it's updating almost at least every day, sometimes twice a day. Just so keep an eye on that. Thank you for that question.
Thank you very much. I've got Representative Nakamura followed by Representative Tarnas next.
I wanted to thank you again for all the good work and the surprise. I wanted to ask you about the what happens if a person does not have a home to be sheltered in? And related to that, what happens to the people in that home who will then be exposed to potential coronavirus?
Yeah, that is a very good question. I have to say we would be working very closely with various partners, the county of the home where the individual is, healthcare providers, the individual themselves, as well as DHS and other critical partners to identify appropriate facilities and means for making sure that person is safe, that our community is safe. I can't really answer the specifics because it would be case by case basis. Okay.
Representative Thomas.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Dr. Park, for being here and emphasizing the need to control our flu outbreak. It's even perhaps even more important. However, all the media attention and our constituents are focusing on the coronavirus. Could you please explain to us how CDC keeps us informed? What is your protocol for being kept up to date? Because we're depending so much upon the federal government and CDC to take the lead. So I understand that, you know, the Lieutenant Governor and our DOH Director and many others just came from a briefing. Mm-hmm. How often do those briefings take place? How is this communication happening so that we understand the coordination between the federal government and our state government?
Sure, and I'm going to defer the question about the state briefings to people higher than me, shall we say. as far as how CDC is keeping us informed, we've always had good relationship, obviously, and for obvious reasons, with CDC for a number of different diseases. This is no different. I can tell you that there have been multiple calls. In fact, through the weekend, I've been on multiple calls with CDC colleagues as well as other states' colleagues. So anytime there is something like this, H1N1, SARS, you know, Ebola, I'm trying to think of all the different Zika virus, you can, what happens is CDC and CSTE, which is the Council of State and Territorial Epidemiologists, get together, collaborate to engage all state epidemiologists and other relevant partners. At the same time, CDC engages other partners within health departments, so preparedness directors, various other folks, to basically pull us all together to just start having conversations. For the state epidemiologists, we're primarily talking about the science, the infection control issues, as well as how to implement and, you know, issues around quarantine. We're giving feedback to CDC directly from the ground level in terms of how their guidance is being received and what, you know, how we perceive their guidance. They're vetting some of their guidance with us. Some of us, like myself, are in a more select group with CDC where we're on a task force. We're actually really closely vetting some of that actual guidance. So that ongoing communication, it continues even now. Obviously, some of us cannot be in 10 places at once. I am fortunate to have some very good staff on board, and so at some points I'm delegating to some of the key staff to make sure we're covering all bases. But I can assure you, there's a lot of communication happening, both with CDC, but our biggest concern is making sure we're communicating with our partners within the state so that it's not just we're getting the information and it doesn't go anywhere, because that's not useful to our community. So we are also very quickly trying to turn it around and package it. In fact, I can tell you we're getting ready to send out another medical advisory just to make sure our clinicians are still on the same page.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Any further questions?
Yes,
I've got Representative Wahlberger and then Representative Cavanaugh after.
Thank you, Chair. I have a HNL question, so I'm perhaps Department of Transportation. I'm curious to know exactly how many flights are coming in from China now into HNL as a person forced to involuntarily occupy HNL facilities and OGG facilities. I have extreme concerns, and I was wondering if we are actually physically taking temperatures of arriving passengers before they come to customs and control agents.
We don't have any more flights. The last flight that comes directly from China came yesterday. So we don't have any more. And Delta, American, United Airlines have canceled all of their flights from China.
Chair, if I could ask, if we could have the Department of Transportation provide their briefing before members ask questions, because I think if they give their briefing, it might answer some of the questions already on the folks' minds. If the Department of Transportation could give their presentation.
Representative, are you okay with that, or what's your...
I just have a question for Dr. Park, real quick answer. Question.
Go ahead, Dr. Park. Sorry, appreciate it. And then we'll go to the Department of Transportation thereafter.
Obviously, the mode of transportation is respiratory, that's why everybody's wearing masks. Is there any other mode of transmission, for example, feces?
At this time, I believe you were referring to the research article that was published in the New England Journal quite recently, where they found detected molecular elements of the virus in feces. And I would stress those are molecular elements, so RNA material. That does not translate immediately to viability of the virus. So at this time, we do not have any data to support fecal oral transmission. Also, I would stress that the data that we do have does point to this is acting just as a respiratory virus. We would expect a respiratory virus to act. And the CDC has commented that as far as they're concerned, we have to focus on the respiratory transmission of this disease. That is probably the primary mode and the most important mode of transmission. And I would point to the example of flu. Look at how efficiently flu can be transmitted, spread in our communities. Now, this is a respiratory pathogen. And so that is honestly my concern, as well as many in public health and the medical field, in terms of how quickly this can spread as a respiratory pathogen.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Chair. No more questions.
Thank you, Dr. Anderson. We're going to go to you just in a few minutes. I want to go to the Department of Transportation, who patiently been waiting. Director Jade Lutai, please come on up. And would you want Deputy Director Higashi to join you?
Well, sure.
Okay. Yes. And the Honolulu Fire Chief, did you want to join them?
Yeah, we also have Chief Glenn Mitchell.
Thanks, Chief. Director, thank you for being here.
As I mentioned, we don't have any more direct flights from China. It's China Eastern. They arrived yesterday. I'll just add, I want to just associate the comment that Dr. Park made as our own testimony as well. We don't have a briefing, but I'll just, our our firefighters, they've been, you know, they've been training on the coronavirus. You know, they're ready and prepared to respond and assist the CDC. You know, and I'll just add to that, Chinese nationals are not permitted to come to the United States. So the only ones we're screening are, you know, American citizens, permanent residents, and whatnot. And
I'm Ross Igasha, the Deputy Director for the Airports Division. I just wanted to add that we do have procedures for readiness for this should a situation occur for all of our airports that are concerned. So we're ready. And again, our ARF unit with, I got Chief Mitchell here, they're ready for, they've been trained and certified to support the CDC. And I just also wanted to emphasize that again, we await more information and instruction from the CDC as to what the airport is to do should the situation arise.
Thank you. Honolulu Fire Chief Glenn Mitchell.
As stated, all of the personnel have been trained. Our posture to respond hasn't. You know, we always take precaution. But now, with the training given by the CDC, we're able to assist in the screening process. The training will be extended first to Kona, Ellison, Onizuka International Airport, because they do have an international flight, and then to Maui and Lihue, upon the schedule from the CDC staff. So, you know, ARF has always been a part of the surveillance program that CDC has, and the training that we had this past week was more of an update, giving our guys some time to ask questions. All protective equipment is now and has been available for personnel, but I think it's one that we are in readiness in case we need to be called upon.
Thank you, Fire Chief. Members, are there any questions?
Yes, Majority Leader Bilotti.
Based upon what Dr. Park described, in that there were three different groups, a mandatory group, travelers from China, and home residents, what is the capacity at the Honolulu International Airport for the mandatory group quarantine? And has there been anyone? I believe the information was that there was no one in the mandatory quarantine group at this time.
I'm going to defer that because, like I said, we will take care of people's medical needs at the airport. We will swab them, but all that other care or movement is downstream, I think, per se, from the DOT.
Okay, so the basic question is there quarantine places at the airport now?
No, and I'm going to actually defer that question to Dr. Anderson, mostly because that is being worked out in terms of what the actual facility may be, is actually worked on, being worked out at a higher level. But I will say, again, remind you that the screening, the identification of these individuals is done first by our federal partners, and then when they are identified, and right now there are zero. We are not aware of anyone from the hot zone at this time fulfilling this criteria for that hot group, that mandatory quarantine. But if and when they might be, and it's pretty much waiting until Wednesday, because after Wednesday, we all can breathe a sigh of relief that we probably won't see any because it's been 14 days or more from the lockdown, okay? But up until then, we're all sort of leaning forward. And if we hear of any, then CDC will let the state know, and we work with all our partners in terms of making sure those individuals will stay in mandatory quarantine. For our part, at least my program and what I oversee, we will continue to monitor, we will facilitate, and there are ill individuals among that group, facilitate getting healthcare access, making sure specimens are collected appropriately and sent to CDC. But as far as the location or what the details of that, I will defer to my director on that one.
Thank you. Any further questions? Department of Transportation, thank you very much for being here. Tim, thanks. Director Anderson, please come on up. And I see Lieutenant Governor Green there. Did you want to say a few words after
Okay.
Thank you, Mies.
Thanks, brother. Director, thank you for being here.
I apologize for not being here when your informational briefing started. Actually, we were meeting with the civil defense and other agencies to be sure that everyone had the same information. And I appreciate your indulgence. I'm not going to say much except respond to questions and the few that I've just heard. I don't want to repeat what Dr. Park has already said, probably covered most of the issues. With regard to Dr. Tarnas' question about meeting, yes, we are meeting and teleconferencing at least a couple few times a day with other states involved with this. One of our objectives is to try to handle the situation the same way other states are, not to do anything less or more, but to deal with the issues as best we can in a more uniform way. And I think we've accomplished that. But I've been on the phone virtually most of the weekend, and I expect that'll happen for some time. I think there's one thing that I've heard several people ask about that needs clarification. There was an effort to repatriate U.S. citizens from China, and this came up about a week ago, where they were moving large numbers of U.S. citizens, mostly DOD dependents, out of China to back to the United States. They identified three locations for those individuals. And we're looking at about 1,000 people that are being moved back here, back to the mainland to go through a quarantine period there. We actually were one of the states that was identified early on as a host for that, if you will, and we felt we didn't have the facilities here to support that. So they ended up dropping us from that list, and now we're going to other places for that. But what we're left with is, of course, the stream of travelers who are coming back, U.S. citizens coming back to Hawaii. And although flights from China, direct flight from China, there was only one that was really active up to today, that's East China. All those flights have been now discontinued. There's still the likelihood of passengers coming through other ports, indirectly coming to Hawaii, flying to some other international destination, and then being routed back to Honolulu. And we're treating those the same way we would the direct flight. There's no difference in terms of how they're being screened. They're met by the CDC staff at the airport. Of course, they're briefed on the issue. They're collecting information on those individuals. And of course, if there's a history of travel to Wuhan, Hubei province, they will be treated the same way they would if they came directly from those areas and be quarantined. But having said that, the number of travelers is diminished largely because of that. And as you've probably been reading in the paper, many countries have stopped allowing anyone from China to enter their countries. So you can imagine if they go to a country that stopped that, that's a screen that keeps people from coming back here, for better or worse. So I expect the numbers to drop down dramatically as a result of not having any direct flights here. And as Dr. Park pointed out, because of the essentially closure of Wuhan and Hubei province entirely by Thursday of this week, which is 14 days into the incubation period, we should have no one coming to Hawaii from that area that's been there in the last 14 days. So we're probably talking about a handful of people that are going to require this this mandatory quarantine. I am very pleased to in fact, this is, you're the first to hear this, to announce that we do have a site for the quarantine. We've been working closely with the military on this issue, and they've stepped forward and offered a site at Pearl Harbor for this. It's an ideal site, as we think, as we see it. The bases are, of course, preferred. They're being used in most situations for this purpose because they have secure facilities, limited public access, and they have support facilities for support staff to help provide meals and other wraparound services that those individuals will need for the 14 days they're here. So that's a huge relief for all of us, and I really thank the military for recognizing the federal role in this. And let me emphasize, this is a federal mandate, and as such, it's appropriate that they do step in, and they did. And I want to congratulate them for that. But we are working with them on making sure that this whole issue is handled well. We've been working closely with the city and county, which will be providing transport. Should we have an individual here that needs to be transported to the facility? And of course, if there is a person who becomes ill, city and county is well trained to handle individual respiratory disease. It will be taken to a hospital and treated there. Whereas you've heard earlier today, they have a lot of experience in dealing with communicable diseases and negative pressure rooms and things to for sure that there won't be any communicable disease risk to staff or other patients in those settings. So I think we've got everything kind of lined up pretty well right now. I'm going to sleep well tonight knowing we've got a place where people could go if and when we have someone who needs that type of service here. And with that, let me just stop. And if you have any specific questions, again, I don't want to repeat what's been said already.
Thanks, Director. I'm going to look to see if our colleagues have questions. Dr. Morrow?
Thank you very much for that update. It's very reassuring. If someone on the neighbor island is suspected to have coronavirus, and are there similar plans for location for people who may not have a home?
Well, let me emphasize one point that I think probably needs to be understood. In all these screening programs we have at the airports are good. I mean, we're doing what we can to contain the outbreak and to prevent it from coming to Hawaii. But the reality is that there are now, I think the count is 11 cases across the country. None of those cases were caught at airports or harbors or anywhere else. They were people who reported that they were ill and had a history of going to China. He self-reported, essentially, and then we were able to follow up on them and their contacts. So the most likely scenario that we have here is the same, that someone would have been traveling or being exposed somehow to the virus and then coming home or staying here in a hotel or whatever the case may be, and that they would then develop their illness and then report, or we would identify the individual as being a case. But that would be after they're here, they're either in a hotel or in their home. Now, most of those cases we would treat in the home. We would quarantine. We'd monitor the individual. In some cases, we'd actually have staff there to ensure that the person was not in a situation where they would expose others to the virus. We'd probably also quarantine any family members or people they've been in close contact with. That's how we handle these situations normally. And we do have the capability of doing that, whether it's in a home or a hotel. That's the preferred way of handling it. Obviously, the person's sick and needs hospital attention, they go to the hospital, and the hospitals have facilities for that purpose. But that's worked very well in the past in dealing with respiratory illness, and something we feel can be applied here in a very safe manner. Now, if they're non-compliant for other reasons, just say they don't care, and they're not willing to restrict their activities to their home or their apartment or a hotel room, wherever they are, and we will be monitoring that very, very carefully. I do have the authority, the Director of Health has the authority, wherever they are, to require quarantine. I have to go back to the court and get an order after a few days, but having said that, we have the authority now to take whatever actions we need to do that, and believe me, we will. If there's any question of whether the person is going to be compliant or there's a risk, we'll resolve any uncertainties in favor of protecting the public health. But hopefully we won't go there. And again, if we do require quarantine, we do have a facility now that I think is ideal for that purpose.
Are there further questions? Yes, Minority Leader Ward.
I have a question to Dr. Anderson and Dr. Green. How did we get on the list in the first place? A very basic question, because look, half of our economy is tourism. If we get any of these things and it puts a bugaboo into the population, that's a real economic hit to already a struggling population.
Was there any negotiating? Was there any tier two? Have you got an emergency land in Hawaii? Versus, hey, you're one of the big seven. You're comparable to Chicago, comparable to Los Angeles. Hey, no way. How did we happen to get it? Did you guys fight for it?
You're going to have to ask your Republican colleagues about that, I think. But having said that, let me ask.
You didn't push back at all.
No, we did. The reason we're not home for the individuals who were repatriated is because I said it was inappropriate to put these people up in hotels. We don't have another facility for them that can handle that many people coming. They were talking at the time about 200 plus people on each flight coming to Hawaii, and that was off the table. I don't know why they considered Hawaii initially in that group of four. It's now three.
And most flights fly over us anyways. Dr. Green, do you want to add anything to that?
Thank you, Gene. So the first choice of seven sites came before we had any heads up. So that was announced by the Health and Human Services Director and the National Security folks, the Homeland Security guys. So we had immediate follow-up phone call right after that. So our eyebrows raised just like everyone else's, yours, all the people. We didn't want that to happen. And so we did push back right away. They then subsequently added four other sites on Sunday. So there were now 11 sites.
What are the other four?
Three Ds, Dallas, Dulles, and Detroit, and then Newark. Now, having said that, things are telescoping very quickly and changing. So as Director pointed out, the repatriation of the 1,000 individuals that are coming out of the Hubei province will go to the mainland where there are military installations, and Director Hub fought and successfully kept that not from coming to Hawaii. So that was a success. People over time who live in Hawaii will return to Hawaii, and that's where we have to continue to be vigilant for our own people. But the other things that happened in the interim from Friday till Sunday was the planes were canceled, so that was East China Airways. Those flights ended yesterday, so we now have no more direct flights. So it became to a degree a moot point. The final concern, of course, remains that we are still on the list in case there has to be an airline that lands. We do not expect that to happen, as you've heard from others. There are not going to be a significant number of people from the index hot zone area that we have to worry about as much. But we are still very mindful of the whole process because, as you know, with outbreaks, it's unpredictable how big an outbreak this will become. Will it be truly a pandemic and be global? Will other countries see a denser infectious rate and that they are the same concern like China was? So these are the reasons that we want to still go ahead. And I reiterate the good news that the director just gave us, that we will have a military base in case we have to do any mandatory quarantine. Otherwise, we have been beefing up our capacity with multiple levels of protection for the last several days.
So the people of Hawaii have no real worry or concern as to what we can do or can't do, or everything is taken care of. And especially if by Wednesday, do we pop champagne corks, or is it like, hey, be careful, Wednesday is only kind of not a magic Wednesday, but something that said there's at least a little bit of light at the end of the tunnel?
Well, things will be better, but let's be very clear. It's very likely that the outbreak internationally will last for several months. We'll be following it every day with calls to the CDC, where we have multiple points of contact, including the head of the CDC and speed dial. So we will be mindful that anyone who travels be checked to make sure they don't bring disease, or that we at least see if there are any signs. We'll follow up any risks, and that's what Dr. Park's excellent department does. And then finally, we will not have to worry about incoming flights from China because the president's administration, the administration, has decided there won't be flights in from China, Chinese nationals, that is. So keep in mind, we have 200,000 citizens, U.S. citizens, that live in China, although most of them are going to stay there as they live there, work there, and so on. We don't expect to have large numbers of people coming back, but over January, February, March, April, May, people will be traveling from time to time, and we'll be on it from a Department of Health and CDC standpoint.
Just to keep this in perspective, my staff has shared the fact that there's already 10,000 deaths this season for flu alone. 180,000 people have been hospitalized for the flu season.
Yep.
So in a way, we're kind of really something that hasn't really blossomed yet. We can't overstate it because given what already is out there in terms of flu season.
Right. You make the most important point, and Sarah makes that point very eloquently and often. Get your flu shots, please, so that we don't have to worry about people not being immunized, and then we're wondering, do you have the flu? Do you have some novel other virus? So that takes that off the table. This weekend alone on call, I saw several people with the flu, and I had many people ask the same question, could I have coronavirus? The answer was no. They didn't have any contact, they had the flu, but I need them to get their flu shots and wash their hands. We will see many more fatalities. The death rate of the flu in general is about 1 in 1,000. 1 out of 1,000 cases, someone will die. The death rate of the novel coronavirus is higher than that, significantly higher than that. We don't have the final number yet. This thing evolves, but it might be 2 to 3 people per 100. So it's much more lethal. And so we're scared of that in public, but as long as we do a good job preventing spread, we'll be fine. SARS, when it hit us in 2009, it had obviously far, far fewer cases than the flu, but I believe something, was it 13 people out of 100? Something like that, that were fatal cases. So that's 130 times more lethal than the flu. So that's why we do get much more concerned about these kind of infections.
Thank you. Thank you much.
Thank you. Other questions, members?
Director.
Yes, Director.
Can I just emphasize one point that I think has been said once or twice here, but needs to be clear. You know, the fact that China's closed its borders, or at least we've shut them down, isn't a panacea to this problem. It's a pandemic now. It's occurring everywhere. China has the vast majority of cases, but there are at least 20 confirmed cases in Japan. Philippines just announced someone has died there from the disease. So this is going to go the way that many of these infectious diseases go, where it starts somewhere, and it seems to have started in Wuhan, and it's spread throughout Hubei province. Now we're seeing the disease in different places. So the fact that we don't get any flights directly or indirectly from China is helpful, and certainly will be reassuring, I think, to people to know that the epicenter of this outbreak, we're not going to see much travel. But I have to say that if we think the problem's going to be over because they've closed those borders, that's not the case. It is going to continue to be an issue for as long as this session occurs, and probably quite longer than that. I can guarantee that it's not going to go away just because we've stopped travel from here to China and back and forth. So we need to continue to be vigilant about it. These international flights are going to continue to come to Hawaii from other places where they have the disease. So we're in this for the long haul. It's not something that we can expect is going to go away as a problem, but we are on it. We're being vigilant. Everyone in the medical community knows about the disease. I'm confident that if we do have a case, it's going to be identified very early. We're going to be able to identify the contacts and treat them quickly and appropriately when that happens. So we're doing the best we can, and I think we're as good a shape as anyone is to deal with this.
Dr. Anderson, if my constituent says, should I wear a mask, what do I tell them?
No, it's not necessary. You know, masks are helpful to keep you from infecting other people. That's why they wear a mask when they operate on you. They're not as effective to prevent you from becoming infected. The paper is just simply not a good filter for a virus. It's good for keeping someone from sneezing and creating a respiratory aerosol, droplets or whatever, and it's effective for that reason. But the experts have said that the typical paper face mask that you wrap around your ears and you wear over your face is practically useless for preventing you from becoming sick from somebody else. But if you are sick, it's helpful to wear because it prevents you from coughing and sneezing and infecting other people. So for many people, it's a comforting thing. You put a mask on and you feel like you've done something, and it may help a little bit, but it's certainly not proven effective to prevent the transmission of the disease.
Gene, don't hold your nostril and
don't
do that.
Do
you know,
those things.
Yeah.
And I'll tell my Hawaiian Airlines constituent too, as he just said.
Thank you.
Any further questions, members? Yes, Dr. Cragen.
Yeah. I had a question, actually.
she had a niece and nephew traveling to Taiwan. They decided to extend their stay there and go on a lengthy bike trip. So in places like Taiwan, which, you know, could become a hot spot in some cases, would you advise people to tell people in areas like that to get home before they can't get home? In other words, do you anticipate, you know, the logical spread of this virus, which they can get here before you can't get here?
You know, we very early on advised that no one traveled to China unless they absolutely had to go. It was a non-discretionary issue. You know, if we follow the disease, I think you're going to need to look at where the disease is occurring and make your own personal choices as to where you go. But I would say this, I would say at this time, if you're looking to travel to a place where there's a considerable amount of this disease, it would be wise to do so. If you're planning to go on vacation or just to visit family, friends, and so forth. On the other hand, most of the world's not affected by this. Certainly the United States is relatively free of the disease. We have a few cases here and there. It's not as transmissible as a lot of the other infectious diseases. So I see no issue associated with going to most of the world, but I would certainly be cautious about going into these areas. So I would monitor what's going on, keep an eye on who's reporting cases, and then make your own decision. We haven't put out a formal advisory to anyone, except as it relates to China, and that's for obvious reasons. And I'll just leave it at that.
Okay. We have another question. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
There's a follow-up, sorry. A place like Thailand, you know, where they're having right there cross border. Is that a place, is the CDC starting to stratify places? Like China, obviously, is not a no-go place, but places around there, are they being stratified, or, you know?
You know, they have a running tabulation of number of confirmed cases in various countries. It changes from day to day. One thing I would urge that you consider when you look at that is it's probably grossly underreported. The number of people who are actually infected is probably, could be 10 times or more higher than what you're seeing. We're just learning about the cases. And even in China, where they have, you know, 17,000 cases, I've heard estimates that it could easily be over 100,000, 10 times as high or more. It depends on the healthcare system and how active they are and identifying new cases, and that varies considerably from one place to another. But if you do see a place that has lots of cases, obviously I would be cautious about going there. But as it is, the only advisory that we put out that we would certainly support is that you not travel to China at this point in time. Thank you. And by the way, I should say Hong Kong and other places have not been identified as areas that have Singapore, Hong Kong, as far as I know, they have not had a significant number of cases. But that may change tomorrow.
Thank you.
We've got Majority Leader Bilotti with a question.
Director, if I can direct this question to you, and it's actually building off of Representative Tarnas' question. I'm actually looking at the Johns Hopkins website now that has the cases and the confirmed cases. Is there a conversation internationally? Because it looks like, and you're right, there's 20 from confirmed cases in Japan, 19 in Thailand, 18 in Singapore, 15 in Hong Kong, 15 in South Korea. Is there an international conversation occurring so that if these numbers start to jump in these other places, that there's a communication with the United States and with us? Because we are a source of international travel.
Yeah, we have more international travelers than probably most places in the U.S., for sure. And people here who travel internationally as well. So I can say the World Health Organization has declared this as a pandemic and a public health emergency. And as such, they put out that's a cautionary message for anyone who's interested in traveling. The United States, as far as I know, has not issued any travel advisories except for China at this point in time. So I don't want to offhandedly say that Thailand or any of those other places I would recommend not traveling to, but stay tuned. I would again advise that anyone who's going into an area which has lots of cases that they carefully consider their travel and how
Thanks. We've got a question from Minority Leader Ward.
Thank you, Chair. Generally, the legislature has been accused of being ponderously slow to adjust to situations. I would commend the Chair for bringing this quickly and to a hearing such as this. What I wanted to follow back on was the Deputy Director, who said that, well, we're going to get kits in a week or two so we can test our own. That seems ponderously slow if, in effect, we've got an emergency that's going on now and we've got to wait 2 weeks to get a kit. Does that make sense, or did I hear it incorrectly? Why 2 weeks to get kits?
No, let me say this is a new and emerging problem. It's actually remarkably quick that they have been able to develop a test within a month of the time that they first identified it as a problem. Normally it takes a lot longer than that to develop a test. What they have developed now is a PCR type test. It looks for the DNA in the chemical, in the virus that's easily identifiable. It's a test kit. I talk about a kit, but it's basically, it's supplies to enable us to be able to do many thousands of tests that we can replicate easily. It should be ready for distribution to all states. All states are going to be have this kit within a week or so, we're told. You know how that goes. It could be less or it could be a little more than that, but that's the time frame we've been told. Once we get the kit, let me say, we are well trained on how to use it. It's the same procedure that we use for a lot of other things. It's just a very specific test for this specific virus. So our staff are well trained in using the PCR methodologies, and I expect that we won't have to spend weeks or months teaching staff how to use it and to be sure that the test results are reliable. That should be a matter of days. So I'm confident that we're moving as quickly as we can to implement the testing here. And I can only say that I think if you know how things work, it takes a year to develop a vaccine. Normally, they're also accelerating their research on other types of preventive measures like vaccines. And they're talking now about having a vaccine available, hopefully, in the not too distant future. That's many months from now, but having a test ready to go in a month when you didn't even have a test for it is actually a fairly rapid period.
Okay, my last question is that in the epidemiology weeds, some of the things that I've read, whether it's true or not, came out of the wild meat markets in China where bats got eaten by either a chicken and the person ate the chicken. Is some of the logical, or we don't even know where this coronavirus, which sounds like a beer anyways.
This is probably a fair question, but having said that, I think one of the things that's scary about this is it may very well have evolved from a virus that's usually transmitted among animals, bats in particular, that have crossed the line and now we're being infected. Sarah, maybe you can talk about that briefly.
Yes, got it. So what the CDC has advised us and partners is that genetic sequencing reveals that this virus has its origin in bats. However, it didn't likely cross over immediately from bats. It probably came from another animal species that has yet to be identified. It is thought that the mutation occurred quite recently, so it likely crossed over very recently, probably late November, early December. Now, that's all based on what their conjecture is based on looking at genetic sequencing. If you've ever been to a live animal market, which honestly I would not advise at this time or at any time, but if you've ever been and you would see the conditions, the horrible conditions, frankly, that animals are subjected to, and then you have people in very close juxtaposition to these animals that are extremely stressed, they're not well taken care of, so they're probably many of them ill with their own issues. So then if you think about that, and then it's a market to sell for food. So they're being slaughtered right there in front of people. So you have, you know, bodily fluids from animals mixing with humans' lunches and dinners and whatnot. And so basically, it shouldn't be a far stretch then to understand that how contamination can occur, and over time, someone could be exposed to something that then leads over to the human side. But what we do understand is it appears that this virus does seem to have some efficiency for human-to-human transmission, and that is the focus right now.
But we don't know what ate the bats.
That is, we're so far beyond the bats right now, so.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Park. Any further questions, members, before we close? Okay, before we end, I wanted to thank Lieutenant Governor Green for being here. Thank you. Look forward to working with you on protocol. Healthcare Association of Hawaii, Hilton, thank you for being here and really telling the lawmakers here that you've got covered hospitals throughout the state, different islands. So thank you for that. We wanted to thank the Department of Transportation, Director Jay Butai, Deputy Director Higashi, and Chief Glenn Mitchell, Honolulu Fire Chief. Thank you for giving us that information. A special thanks to Dr. Anderson for being very honest in saying that we don't have a panacea. There's no silver bullet. We need to be vigilant and continue to be vigilant. So appreciate your honesty, your candor. We want to thank Dr. Park for being fact-driven and explaining to us what we need to look at and also talking about influenza. And I wanted to thank all of you. This is a balancing test. What we don't want to do is cause the state to go in a panic, first of all. And second, what we don't want to do is, unfortunately, this may already be doing this racial profiling. We don't want to do that. So I think it's very important to hear the administration and what everyone's doing, along with the elected officials. So thank you for your candor, and look forward to working with you as we try to navigate out of this novel chronic virus. Thank you very much for being here. I believe our friends from the media may have some questions for you also. Again, thank you very much. This briefing is now adjourned.